Let's continue our look at some discrete probability distributions with an introduction to the multinomial distribution. The multinomial distribution is a generalization of the binomial distribution. In the binomial distribution, there are only two possible outcomes on any one individual trial, and we labeled those success and failure. In the multinomial distribution, the number of possible outcomes on any one given trial is allowed to be greater than 2. Let's take a look at an example. This is approximately the distribution of blood types in the United States. And suppose we wanted to know the answer to this question. In a random sample of 10 Americans, what is the probability 6 have blood type O, 2 have type A, 1 has type B, and 1 has type AB? When any one individual person is sampled, they are going to have one of these 4 blood types according to these probabilities. And we're going to be able to answer this question using the multinomial distribution. Suppose we have n independent trials, and each trial results in one of k mutually exclusive outcomes. And these k outcomes are exhaustive, so one of them is going to occur. On any single trial, these k outcomes occur with probabilities p1 through pk. And since these outcomes are mutually exclusive and exhaustive, then they must sum to 1. We also need these probabilities to stay constant from trial to trial. We're going to let the random variable x sub I represent the number of occurrences of outcome I. And I is going to take on the values 1 through k, representing those k possible outcomes on any one individual trial. So we are going to have k random variables representing the count for each of those possible outcomes. Then the probability the random variable x1 takes on the value little x1 and all the way up through the random variable xk taking on the value little xk is equal to what we have here. Over here on this side we have p1, the probability of outcome 1 on any one individual trial, raised to the number of times that outcome 1 happens, and all the way up to here, which is the probability of outcome k occurring on any one individual trial, raised to the number of times we need outcome k to occur. And so what we have here is the probability of any one specific ordering of x1 occurrences of outcome 1 and x2 occurrences of outcome 2, all the way up through xk occurrences of outcome k. And what we have over here is the number of possible orderings that give us x1 occurrences of outcome 1 all the way up through xk occurrences of outcome k. And so these multiplied together give us the probability of this happening. We really should list out the possible values of x here. The random variable x1 can take on the possible values 0, 1, 2, all the way up through n, and the same is true of x2 and all the way up through xk. So this is true for x sub I equaling 0, 1, all the way up through n. But we know that n things must happen in total, so the sum of all those individual occurrences for I equaling 1 through k must equal n. And if we think about this a little bit, any one of these random variables, when viewed individually, it will have a binomial distribution. And if you remember our mean and variance for the binomial distribution, we can say that the expectation of x sub I is going to be equal to n times p sub I, and the variance of the random variable x sub I is going to be equal to n times p sub I times 1 minus p sub I. And you might remember that from our discussion of the mean and variance of the binomial distribution. Let's return to our example. In a random sample of 10 Americans, what is the probability 6 have blood type O, 2 have type A, 1 has type B, and 1 has type AB? Well, we've got a random sample here, so knowing one person's blood type is going to tell us nothing about the next person's blood type, so that independence assumption is pretty reasonable here. On any one individual trial, we are going to get one of these four blood types. And these probabilities are staying constant from trial to trial. So the multinomial distribution is reasonable here. And we want to find out the probability that the random variable x1, which is representing the number of people in our sample that have blood type O, the probability that takes on the value 6. And our random variable x2, representing the number with type A, that takes on the value 2. And x3 takes on the value 1. And x4 takes on the value 1. And this is going to be equal to n factorial, we've got a sample of size 10, so 10 factorial, over x1 factorial, that's just the number with type O, and that's 6 factorial, times 2 factorial, times 1 factorial, times 1 factorial. And now it's time for these probabilities. The probability blood type O happens on any one individual person is 0.44. And we need that to happen 6 times, so we're going to raise that to the 6th power. And then we're going to multiply that by the probability of blood type A, 0.42, squared, because we needed that to happen twice. And then we're multiplying that by 0.10 blood type B, raised to the 1st power, we need that to happen once. And then multiplying that by 0.04, raised to the 1st power. And if we calculate that, we would see that that is 0.01290 when rounded to 5 decimal places. Let's look at another example here. An urn contains 8 red balls, 3 yellow balls, and 9 white balls. 6 balls are randomly selected with replacement. What is the probability 2 are red, 1 is yellow, and 3 are white? Well, this with replacement is an important notion here. If we are putting the ball back in and shaking it all up and then randomly selecting again, then the individual trials are independent. And the probability of getting a red ball, or a yellow ball, or a white ball, those probabilities are staying constant through the different trials. And so the conditions for our multinomial distribution are satisfied here. And we're interested here in the probability that the random variable x1, which I'm going to let represent the number of red balls, the probability the random variable x1 takes on the value 2, and x2, the number of yellow balls, takes on the value 1, and x3, the number of white balls, takes on the value 3. And this is going to be equal to n factorial, so 6 factorial, over 2 factorial, the number of red balls, times 1 factorial, the number of yellow balls, times 3 factorial, the number of white balls. And now to the probabilities. Well, we have 8 red balls, and there's 8 plus 3 plus 9, 20 balls in total. So the probability of getting one red on any one individual trial is going to be the 8 red balls out of the 20 total. And we need that to happen twice, so we're going to square that. And then we're going to multiply that by the probability of getting a yellow ball on any one individual trial, which is 3 out of 20, raised to the 1st power, because we need that to happen once. And then times 9 out of 20, getting a white ball on an individual trial, cubed, because that's got to happen 3 times. And that works out to 0.13122 to 5 decimal places. Had the sampling been done without replacement, then the trials would no longer be independent, and the conditions of the multinomial distribution would no longer be satisfied. We would have to use something called the multivariate hypergeometric distribution to calculate the probability in this case. And what the heck, let's run through a quick example of that. Here we've got the same problem we just looked at, except I've changed with replacement to without replacement. And there's a fundamental difference there. When I say without replacement, what that means is if we pull out a red ball, we're putting it aside and it doesn't go back in, and then we randomly select another ball. So if we draw a red ball out on the first trial, say, it's going to be less likely to get a red ball on the second trial. So those trials are no longer independent. We've still got our random variables x1, x2, and x3, and we still want to know the probability that a random variable x1, the number of red balls, takes on the value 2, and x2, the number of yellow balls, takes on the value 1, and x3, white balls, takes on the value 3. And we're going to do this through the multivariate hypergeometric distribution. On the bottom, we're going to have the number of possible samples. And we are drawing 6 balls from a total of 20. There are 20 balls altogether. And from those 20, we are choosing 6. So the bottom is going to be the total number of possible samples. In the top, we're going to have the total number of samples that get us what we want. The total number of samples that get 2 red and 1 yellow and 3 white. And for that, we're going to say, well, we need to pick from those 8 red balls, we need to choose 2. So 8 choose 2. And from the 3 yellow balls, we need to pick 1. So times 3 choose 1. And from the 9 white balls, we need to pick 3. 8 choose 2 times 3 choose 1 times 9 choose 3, all divided by 20 choose 6. This is the number of ways of getting what we want over the total number of possible samples of size 6 that can be chosen from 20. And this, if we work this out, to 5 decimal places is 0.18204. A note that's a little bit different from the probability we calculated when it was with replacement.